for these precious people who want to listen to your precious word. Lord, thank you for what you did yesterday. Thank you for the greater things you will do today. Thank you because you will surprise every one of us here. And you showcase your glory. Holy Father, as I teach your word, let your anointing and your power, your fire and your freshness be so felt here this morning.
Amen.
Let everybody here be abundantly satisfied.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
In Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen.
I want to thank the Lord for the way he started with us yesterday. The minister called me, one of the people here, yesterday around after 11. I said I came with some black Americans. And it was just an exciting experience for them. And I thank God also for what Pastor Festus said about the other group that came in. Let's believe God that God is ready to bless.
Amen.
And nobody can hinder him.
Amen.
So you see, like what God told me, that I want to surprise these people.
Amen.
So it depends on you. If you put a limitation on what you can receive from God, I pity you. But you should come to a point that you remove every limitation. I would have wished for me to be there sitting down and listening so that I can key into what God is doing here. But I want to let you know that God is doing something. And by the grace of God, it will be unusual for you to leave this place without having the needed transformation in your life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
This morning, like I said, this is a burden in my heart. I'm talking about the subject, bonding to pray. Will you say it?
Bonding to pray.
Again?
Bonding to pray.
Yesterday I talked about time. It's time to pray. Individually, collectively, congregationally, nationally. But it will be limited. It will not achieve the goal until we come into the point of bonding to pray. As I was meditating and preparing, I discovered that that is what happens in any genuine achievement. Not only bonding to pray, bonding to do anything. Like you say, until there's a real bonding, there's no security of whatever we are doing. But I'm now talking about bonding to pray. What are the things in my mind or in God's mind when I talk about bonding to pray? Just some few points. Number one, I mean bringing ourselves under a strong agreement to pray and to pray through. See, prayer revival is not just to excite you. It's to give you the ingredients, release the anointing, the equipment, so start something that will be continuous. Because I've been listening to Pastor Festus, his desire is something that will be infectious. Something that will be contagious. Something that will move from a small place and move into the entire city and beyond. And that is not possible until there is a bonding. Bonding among families. Bonding among members. Bonding among Christians. Bonding denominationally and interdenominationally. Bonding to pray. That's bringing ourselves under a strong agreement to pray. Number two, what do we mean by bonding to pray? Coming together with a collective resolve to pray. If prayer crusade ends after tomorrow, we have not achieved anything. Prayer crusade, normally it should be to set a platform that will motivate and initiate something that will bring in a very, very big issue. Listen, then, like I told you, you've heard about what happened in South America. That was how it started. It was a bonding. They started little by little coming together until it became a thing that they were using stadia and great things were happening. And anyway, listen to me, like in the case of Nigeria, if you have heard about the revival around 1930, the Joseph Ayo Babalawa revival. Around 1925, some people came together, bonded to pray. They were not satisfied. They were in the Episcopalian Church, what we call the Anglican Church. and they were not satisfied, and they felt there could be something more in Christianity. And let's start to seek the face of God. So they came together, about five of them. Esisiande, Udubanjo, and just some people like that, around the Jebudi area. And they were praying. While you were responding to pray, God answers in different places, ways. They were praying around the Jebudi area. But around Ilofa, God raised a man, Yosef Abalola, who is like the greatest revivalist that Africa has produced. You see, you can produce something great outside prayers. Like I said yesterday, there is no substitute to prayer. You want to affect your life, you want to affect your generation, let's all go back, all of us, let's go back to the chambers of prayers. Prayers will not only make a difference in your life, will cause you to make a difference. Amen. A man, a true scandal, a praying man, in everything about your life is different. Yes. Your ministry is different. Yes. Your family is different. Yes. Your messages are different. Your lifestyle is different. Yes. Even the resources you get, God surprises you. Not at what the man of God was saying. You see, that's what happens when you start to pray. God starts to embarrass you with blessings.
Amen.
You see, say ye have not because you ask not. But when God, when you start to pray, God does exceeding abundantly above whatsoever we ask or think. So God raised this young man, Joseph Babalola. By that time, I think he was less than, he was just about 24 years old, 1920 years. He was a steamroller driver. Then God called him a novice, nothing. Then God now directed him to this group who were praying in a Jebude. That was how the thing started. Because these were older people, more experienced people. That was invariably, that was, by 1930, the river had climaxed. In fact, all the missionaries, they said what this man did in 3 months was more than what all the missionaries in Nigeria did in 70 years. That's the beauty of revival. Woo! So, bonding. So, if you still can go beyond this period, I can't tell you what extent God wants to do. So, I am not here just for, like I said, it's fast for the thing, just excite you. I'm not here to excite you. I'm here to give you something solid, move you into it, you either swim or you sink. So and that's what we have started today, yesterday. We continue this morning, go into a greater dimension in the evening until we finish. What we mean by coming together? Coming together, number three, with one sole purpose, prayers. Not just childish prayer. That's why I say this one is more important to me because you here in this morning, you know the reason why you are here. You are not asked to be here. Children will just come and because they want some bread and butter. But you are coming because you know there's something prayer can do in this kingdom. There's something prayer can do in my generation.
Amen.
See, bonding, it does. When you look at some of the things some of us are doing now, some people may not know how we started. I remember all my life I've had a focus. He didn't know that. All my life, the passion I have has been revival. All my life since I gave my life to the Lord. That was brought in the old path. The old path revival. Not ordinary revival, the old time revival. The revival that showcases the genuineness and the authority and the magnitude of Christianity. That has been my cry. And I tell God, I say, for over 40 years, there has been only one cry in my heart. Revival for the ancient glory.
Yes.
Which we have lost. Now we do a lot of things, but that's not the ancient thing. You know, when you see the time of the Zerubbabel temple, when they raised that temple in Ezra chapter 3, all the young men were saying, hallelujah, praise God, anything they could say that time, they were rejoicing and shouting. But the ancients who saw the very first temple, they told them, what were they saying? They were weeping. Please put off that. I didn't know, probably it came up again. Please let me put it off. I tried to put it off. Just knock it on the head there. Knock it on the head and I'll show you how to put it there. Okay. So that's it's been it. I was talking about that was a distraction. I was talking, get me my talk. Yes. They were weeping. That is a far cry from the real thing. Many of you became Christians when Christians had lost his glory. That's the truth. And I say it without hypocrisy. Assembly of God now is not the assembly of God that we used to have. I've been to Springfield, Missouri to go and do research. Not once. All the churches in Nigeria, you see them. This was not the original thing. Before we started, I took Grace of God Constitution. I said that this was not the original Grace of God. I took Christian Pentecostal. This was not it. I pray for World Assembly, don't change.
Amen.
This is all this people, they are just the one generation. Even Church of God, all these people. So I said, look, many of you became Christians when the things have gone bad. One of my sons sometimes was working with the railway. And they said, you people, you know, in those days, if you had that somebody was working in railway or the father, you would envy them. They said, you are the people enjoying, you know. But they said, we joined the railway when the railway has become bad, when salary could not be paid. You became Christians when Christianity is no more what it used to be. And that's why we need people who can connect you to the old. And that's what we are doing. Don't go and get carried away with the semblance of revival. Let's get the real thing. So what I'm trying to say is that let's come together with one soul purpose, prayers. Number four, body to pray is moving and flowing together with one driving force, one driving goal. What is it? Revival. I was telling you, I remember 1974, some of us came together. In fact, we never knew that it would even take this long. Every night, young people like myself, in our early 20s, will pray from 12 to 5 for months. In fact, when we'll be praying, literally the house will be changed emotionally. Literally, we had one passion. We bonded as if only one thing. What? Revival. When you couldn't, that passion was so strong. And that's what I want. You see, you want to make a difference in your generation, you must know what it means to bond your prayer. Let people around you just watch one interest. Prayers. That's me. I'm traveling. I got people around. Most generally, I'm living in Enugu. But most of the time I pass through Lagos. I bring some of my minister children. Say, I'll be arriving around this time. Please give me 2 hours, give me 3 hours, give me 4 hours. What is it? Coming to pray. Before I came in, I was in Kaduna, flew to Lagos. In fact, because I wanted to make my appointment, I moved from Kaduna to Abuja to get an early flight. Monday to pray. You can never pray enough. That's the truth. But you see, we've come to a point that people don't know the beauty and the glory and the fullness of prayers. And that's why you see us, we are almost like on the defensive. Mm-hmm. I can assure you, Kamusta, after just from what we do now, see what will happen in your life in the next 30 days. Yeah. I mean it. Amen. I will be checking off from Pastor Festus. If you don't have a testimony, there must be something seriously wrong with you. Something seriously wrong. Because there's no way when we pray, something happens.
Amen.
When you pray, heaven opens. There's no other way, not the acrobatics of Pentecostals. We've done much of this acrobatics and we've not received anything. Yes, we have seeming large crowds, but large crowds that are so superficial. Large crowds that are not having the depth of it. Listen. When revival comes, listen, those things. Let me tell you a little bit. This, when you get anything through revival, it becomes so real and rich. When the revival took place that time, we have key employers like John Holt, PWD, all those people. They will write to the church, send us 10 clerks, 2 accountants, three messengers, when they come, are you from so-so-so place? They will say, they don't interview them. They know they will not misbehave. Not today when Christians are there. Yeah, they are even, Christians are cheating their pastors, they are cheating the church.
Yes.
And the common saying that I prefer having business with an unbeliever than with the, I say that's the greatest insult. You are insulting my calling. If all I do, an unbeliever is greater than a person I have, who under my preaching, then you may come, I'm a failure. Well, that's the state of the church. But those days, they so have confidence in them because they know that everybody as a product of the revival, they call them people who see money and will not steal. A woman, they will never cheat. They will never steal. Not to the way people are. So I'm saying, but this is when you have the foundation of prayers, born to pray, having a strong and united mind to pray and to achieve definite things through prayers. What is bonding? Bonding is based on the power of unity, togetherness, and agreement. You must know the power of it. United we stand, divided we fall. And bonding shows that I cannot do it alone. You know, I don't do anything for the fun of it. When I say hold your hands, I believe say, one can chase a thousand, two can put 2,000 to 10,000 to fly. And he says, if two of us can agree on it concerning any. So one thing you must understand is you don't just do anything for the fun of it. So that's the principle that is behind it. Look at Deuteronomy 32, verse 29. Deuteronomy 32, 29. He says, oh, that they were wise, that they understand this, that they will understand their latter head. Verse 30, how should one chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to fly? So that shows you the exceptional, extraordinary power of togetherness and unity. And our Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 18, verse 18, he says, verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. But again I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. So, what we are trying to say is that this meeting should lead to some definite agreements. Agreements within the world assembly, agreement within the community, agreement within the city. If not, we will have wasted it, all the efforts, all the resources. Let me give you a typical example of bonding. I see some lessons we can learn, we can get from it. In Acts chapter 23, I read verse 12 and verse 13. Acts 23, verse 12 and 13. And when it was certain, and when it was day, certain of the Jews banded together. That's where I got the word. Banded together and bound themselves, saying that they will neither eat nor drink till they have killed Paul. So, verse 13, and they were more than 40 which had made this conspiracy. So, what I said, that whether good or bad, not many greatness can be achieved without a bonding. Yes. More than 40 people in verse 16. And when Paul's sister's son heard of their lying in wait, he went and entered into the castle and told Paul. Then Paul called one of the centurions unto him and said, bring this young man unto the chief captain, for he had certain thing to tell him. So he took him and brought him to the chief captain and said, Paul, the prisoner, called me unto him and prayed me to bring this young man unto thee, who has something to say unto thee. Verse 19, the chief captain took him by the hand and went with him aside privately and asked him, what is it that thou hast to tell me? And he said, the Jews have agreed to desire thee that thou wouldest bring down Paul tomorrow into the council, as though they would inquire somewhat of him more perfectly. But do not yield unto them, for there lie in wait for him of them more than 40 men who have bound themselves with an oath that they will neither eat nor drink till they have killed him. Paul never took it for granted, because he knows that when there's a bonding, there will be an achievement. And why is it that the church is so weak today? We all go at cross purposes. No bonding. And that's why you see that the world is not yet adequately evangelized. It's painful. I was in Lausanne 3 in Cape Town 2010. They brought prominent Christian leaders from over, I think, about 200 countries of the world. But when I was there, there was a cry in my heart. Where are the genuine people? Where are the Pentecostals? Where are those who understand the power of God to achieve great things? I've been a mission man all my life, moving around. Where are the people who can? But the problem with Pentecostals, they never come together. Everybody wants to run his own alone, own part alone, one assembly alone. Oh, yeah. Reading prayer alone. Winners alone. Everybody! Alone. Oh, when I was there, my heart was crying. Where are these people who could do this? No, the evangelicals will not do that. They are the people spending their money. You hear about this Lausanne movement, World Evangelical Fellowship. They are all evangelicals from Billy Graham, from Lausanne 1 in 1974. Going to Manila Manifesto in 1989, they are spending money. After that 2000, they spent $35 billion. But every church wants to be its own kingdom. Oh, I saw the representative of where I was before, and I called him. I said, Brother John, there's a body in my heart. What these people are doing, your church can do it. Our former place can do it. You have the resources. And at this stage, you will look beyond the denomination. Amen. That look, our pastor now at this age, he should not be thinking about these people. Because when, you see, the exposition was Ephesians, the 6 chapters. Ah! I said, give this to my pastor. He will pieces it. But what they did there was like a shampoo. Because this man is a trained teacher. A seasoned, anointed teacher from God. But the problem is that he will say, you don't move along with us, we can move along with you. And my heart was, I said, listen, so when later I saw him, he said, I saw him. When I saw him, I told him that this is what Brother Alfred said, and I agreed with him. He said, Alfred said that? He said, yes, I agree with him. In fact, the last day I saw the assemblies of God, when I left the last night, so I don't teach church. I was with my heart, with my eyes in tears. When the next morning I called the assemblies of God man, Pastor Amma, I said, sit down. I said, let us pray. I said, you are assemblies of God. Are you ashamed to be Pentecostals? You can give leadership. You can bring things together for us to make a significant mark on our generation. He said, yes, Jesus, he was there. He's a very, very, you know, how can I be in a conference? In the old conference, I don't think I mentioned Holy Ghost 10 minutes all through for 8 days. How do we have impact on the whole world? He said, I said, when you get back, then Reverend Dr. Osweke, that this is what Pastor Etiowe said. You see how we can bond and do great things for our generation. Say that is true. When I delivered my message, I didn't know. I was coming from a vision meeting in Abuja. I saw the present General Overseer, Professor Paul Emeka. Ah! I said, sir, can you give me 5 minutes? I said, this was a message I sent to your predecessor. He said, Pastor, you are correct. When we get to it, we will talk more. Probably tomorrow. See, these things, we can achieve more. Yes, you can imagine the church in the city. We come together. All the churches in the nation. We will take the whole continent and beyond the continent. But the problem is that everybody is running in Europe. Everybody's running in Europe. Bonding to prayer. So these people are bonding that with this bond. And if I take any chance, I'm gone. Because there was always power in bonding. Listen to me. In bonding, there are usually five common issues. Number one, there's a common cause. What was the common cause here? Paul must die. He has a little more than enough. Paul must what? Die. That should be all. So what is our common cause? There must be revival. We must see revival in our generation. We must see God's glory in our generation. We must see unity in our generation. There must be a common cause. So their common cause was Paul must not continue. Number two, there should be common concerns. This man has taken away many of our converts, or many of, you know what they were saying when they were great in Diana of Ephesus. What's the problem? Yeah, they made us lose many of our customers. So they were concerned that if we leave this man alone, we will become poor. Where we have been making money from? What are our common concerns? Evil is spreading. Islam is spreading. Occult groups are spreading. They are moving fast. But Christianity, instead of getting stronger, we are getting weaker. They say Christianity nowadays is 1 mile long, half inch deep, superficial. Is that not your concern? Is it nothing to you? Is it nothing to you? That you start to see, even some of us from different places, today, you see Alani and Ngozi, it's an abnormality. You see Alani present. People, because of the allurement of the world, see with all the big things, numbers we are saying, yet crime is on the increase. We are not making any societal impact. Common concern that how long will we continue like this? Number three, there should be common commitment. Yeah, there was a commitment. No eating, no. We will not eat. That means there's always a price to pay in bonding.
Yes,
sir. You see, all of us, you have something that a common commitment to the price that all of them said, no eating, nothing. So there was that commitment. Then number four, there should always be a common confidence that with this agreement, this all is God, and we finish it. You see, there was that confidence that coming together we stand the valley we fall. That confidence that this thing we are doing will produce result. And that's why I'm so confident that what we are doing here is not just for this church. God has just raised up a man, giving him the vision, but common confidence. And I know, I've had him say that by the grace of God, it's just a matter of years. The problem, consistency. The problem again with us is that we are not consistent. There's always a price to pay. Those people, like I told you, they started praying in 1924-25 before something happened around 1928. There's always something, consistency, that will bring something. Then finally, a common conclusion, common consummation. What was the conclusion? Paul must go. In body, there are internal situations that manifest in the external. Internal things, the internal agitation. This Paul. And already it's affecting the world. Have you seen this Paul? This Paul, I'm getting concerned though. I'm getting disturbed. The rate at which this man is going is something internal that manifests in the external. There are definite prices to pay in the bonding. It can be expensive. Can be expensive. Don't you see many of these people? Look at what happened in Joss recently. It was the last. The suicide bombers. You see, again, that's what I'm saying, that it's only in Christianity that we're not ready to pay any price. Obviously, they have come together. What they did, you start your own first. Then in 30 minutes, I will detonate my own. They made it and they killed the people. They killed about 120 people. And the painful thing from what I heard, that there were about 7 medical students. University of Jos. Painful. But you see what they achieved? Done within 30 minutes. Damn it. What's the problem? Today, a church wants to have a program like this, another church fixes another program like that. As if it's not only you can do it. I'm not mad at it. Why can't we come and say, Pastor Festus, we're backing you up? This is for the kingdom. Today, we are no more kingdom-minded, we are denominationally minded. Denomination. Let me tell you a little bit about my story. I told you a little bit yesterday. When the Lord said, bring ministers together, I said, God, I've done a lot of running around. I've been preaching here since 1982. I've been moving all around. I don't know how many passports I've used. So I said, I want to live a quiet and peaceable life. But God kept on sending people from different churches. You don't do it, I will not be happy with you. So 2001, January 30th, I took a bold step. That was when we had the first meeting. 3 things were outstanding. Number one, I fixed it for a Tuesday. Number two, I said everybody to come fast. Not today to get ministers' attention, take them to the hotel to give them food, lunch. I said, in fact, I hate that thing. You are insulting my intelligence. You think you cannot reach out to me until you give me food. I can take purposeful decisions depending on what you want to do. You don't need to give me food. You don't get me through the world, the way of my stomach. No! So, then number three, I reach out to all divides, Orthodox, Evangelicals, Pentecostals. And, people felt Pastor Chiwe has missed it this time around. How can he get all these people? But you know, this God, if he's behind something. That first meeting we had, over 600 ministers from about 120 different churches. 120. The white, all the white ministers in the town were there. Pentecostals were there. They were all there. And we started praying from morning, fasting. We went there till evening. I provided what we provided good meal for which they have asked. But that's not where I'm going to. And then they came. I said, thank you, Lord. I have done what you asked me to do. And they said, Pastor Chi, what next? I said, there's nothing next. God said, I bring ministers together and brought them together. Praise the Lord. Well, let me tell you, that was when also revival started in the city. I just was only one message. We did, from that time, we would do more praying. We did more praying. I gave only one message, healing for damaged lives and lands. After that message, like the oldest minister, because all the people were there, all the bishops, the people were there. So one came in, one of the bishops, and said, my brother, can I say something? I said, it's your meeting. Me, all I did was just that message. That was all. I said, it's your meeting. Say it. Then he came. He said, 10 years, 7 months. That's to 2001, January. He said, something happened in this city. I was not there then. And I was so grieved. And I put a curse. He felt cheated. He felt wounded. And I put a curse on all those people who have cheated me. And over the years, I've been watching and seeing those things come to pass. He said, but who can listen to this message and see, am I? He said, today before you, or because we use the press center. And inside the press, we had 12 canopies outside. So we had more people, more than double people outside than inside. So as we were saying it with brokenness and tears, instantaneously everybody broke into tears. There was no dry eyes. That was where the healing of the land started. So So when they said, what next? I said, what next?
Ah, don't want God want me to do.
I said, but if you hear it, Pharaoh, the people that went to pray, and God said, the revival does not come with a snapshot program like that. Ah! You mean I was happy? I thought it. That it must continue. Ah! That was how it continued. Every last Tuesday of the month, whether I am there or not, and the only person who comes to who represents our church, they are all from different churches. Last Tuesday of the month, from January to November, it's only December because of the festivities. We don't have it. Since that time, consistent, even they did it last Tuesday, that was the last Tuesday, they come and they say, that we just want to let you know that it was powerful. And one major thing, revival, we've been praying since 2001. But, like I said, it can be expensive. People start to say, ah, this man does not know what to do with money. In fact, if anybody went to anybody there and said, please, we need money, ah, go to France, don't you? If the man does not know what to do with money. Because they felt financing these programs, paying for everything. We were using press center, we were paying. We moved, when it became too small, we moved to the trade fair. At that time, we were paying 20,000 per city. So if we have a 3 days program, that would be 60,000. So they felt this man, and they will come every time, we have to take something. We give them free book, give them some things. They say, that man does not know what to do with money. Because money is not everything. It's not everything. So that's what has metamorphosed into what we are doing now. And what my children did last week. Already they moved on to Delta State. Now they are moving to Lagos State. I said, move on. Move on, my son. I can't do it. I can't be here and be there at the same time. Because when you get ministers, when ministers are transformed, the whole nation will be transformed. The decadence we have today, it's because we have dedicated ministers. That's it. Like I said, bonding works perfectly. Where we have the same mind and the same manners. The same mind. That's where bonding works perfectly. There are five basic things we see in bonding from these people. Number one, attention. The attention here was Paul. Number two, agreement. Paul must die. Number three, action. No food, no water. So, important there was attention. The city of Atlanta. We're not satisfied with what is happening. What's agreement? We want to see how God will bring a revival in this thing. Then what's the action? Oh, we want to have continuous prayer meetings. Then number four, addiction. This thing, we don't know how long it will take us, but we will not give ourselves rest. And finally, an actualization. So, five things, attention, agreement, action, addiction, actualization. Bonding brings a mutual enthusiasm. You can imagine before those people to know. Look at all these people you are talking about, Boko Haram. Don't deal with all we are doing. Now they give a form. It's a form. We want to tell these people that we are there and we can give. So it's like that a daily issue. It's bonding. Bonding. Or you try enthusiasm. If we die, let us die. You see, these people possess what we have missed. And that's what we see. What's unusual enthusiasm? It's like they are willing to die. Yes. Don't you see Mutalab's son? The father will be one of the richest people in Africa. But he was enthusiastic to die. They sent him to Britain to study. From there, he slipped out to Pakistan to lie about terrorism. That's bonding. Enthusiasm. We've agreed to do something. But where there's no bond, there's no enthusiasm. That's why I thank God for those of you here in the morning. In the evening, I want the whole place to be packed with people. Amen. Because bond, we want to see something happen. And that's what we have been seeing. They're coming from different states. Enugu State, Ebonyi State, Anambra State, and beyond. You see, but it cost my church money. But what's the money? Money is not everything. To organize a program like this, oh, it's expensive. But there's somebody who takes charge of the issues of the kingdom. And the man who is not ready to pay the price will never achieve much. I said, through burning, there's unusual enthusiasm. Through burning, people put in unusual endeavors. They are ready, that was it, to spend and be spent. In burning, there's unusual exhibitions. Yes. Don't you see that man boasting? Look at Osama bin Laden. He said, kill me. But that will not end after that. So you see, the exhibitions, they will make, they look at what they are doing. They will produce video. They are not ashamed. And tough. Exhibiting. And see all of them, just like Osama bin Laden. Every time seeing them carry their rifles, carry as if they are making a mockery of the whole world. That's what can you be put to? That's what Bundy does. Because he knew he was not alone. That's bonding. You see, in bonding, there's an unusual will to accomplish something. The will is strong. They say, where there's a will, there's what? There's a way. People have will. In bonding, there is the world. We have bonded ourselves. People talk tough. When we don't have world, in this generation, we will see revival, and it is far away. You must have a way. Then we must have a word. Yes, we must have the ways of carrying out these things. And then we must have warnings. Those people, they put themselves under a curse. Anybody who does this thing, you are finished. We will finish you. Not like they say, we will burn your house, burn your family, destroy. That's like a warning. Don't bring this thing to me. So many people, out of the fear, they will go hidden. And then, to achieve great things, we need all these things. But you see, today we are too like an easy car. We take God for granted. We do things. I thank God for those of you who were here yesterday. I was impressed. But you see, people take God for granted. If I am now, God, at least I will be there on Sunday. Not people who are born there. Just, look, I agree with the vision of this man of God. This is what we want. And I don't care. I will take time off. I must be there. As I'm so excited seeing those of you in this morning. What do you say to them? We are doing like this guy, but that's why we're not making an impression. Everything is just, I don't have this. God knows. God does not know. Listen to me. You are not getting younger. I'm not getting younger. That's the truth.
Yes.
When will we make an impression? I'm in my 60s. All of you are getting older. When will you make an impression? Of your generation. I was before the mirror this morning. I saw the gray hairs. I said, Alfred, this is a marker of stress. That's the truth. When will you make an impression of our generation? It's not a matter of women or men. Listen to me. Start to pray.
Amen.
When God raises up women. Look at Amy Marcus. Amy Marcus was very short. The father of Foursquare. The Angelus Temple in California. Nobody, they turn people back. Enter Amy Marcus was a problem. Like I said, she doesn't have the physical stature or anything. But she was a woman of prayers. So when we pray, God raises men or women, children or old people. That's what prayer does. It makes you unique. Start to pray as a woman. God will do with you what he has never done to a man. So, you don't know the potency of prayer. It makes you, men will come and be bowing to you. People as old as your grandfather will bow to you. That's, you see, all of us will come to your point. That's why I say, please, I plead with you. Carry this fire for 30 days. You'll see what will happen in your life. So it's not a matter of your sex. Also, obviously, the Lord has said in the end time, He said, this is your sons and your daughters that prophesy. Even the old men with dreams, they will see visions. He said, God has ordained out of the mouth of babes and sucklings. He has ordained strength. So in this end time, that's part of why it's time to pray. The possibilities of this end time is great. Like I told you, heaven is starved. Not that all heaven is starved, heaven is eager. He said, the eyes of the Lord goes to and fro seeking all shamakama. God is eager. What are the people who take away this shame? From the kingdom. Let me just try to expose a little. Acts of the Apostles chapter 6. Acts chapter 6. Let me read from verse 1. Then we'll see how far we go, then we'll pray. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitudes of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, look ye out among you seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom will be appointed over this business. But we, Kaba, will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. We, the apostles, time to pray is time to go back to the apostolic foundation. We will not become janitors, do everything. What I tell even myself, let's all go. We. These are, he said, we are building on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. That for us, like what I'm saying, our priority, our ultimate concern is to give ourselves to prayers and to fasting. In this text, we see the beauty and power of past of London. Also, we see the test that came to the early church and their triumph. The revival could have been truncated or mad if not for the bonding. We. Listen, men of like minds should always come in only bonding to achieve great things. That's why I thank God for you, Pastor Festus, but don't allow this vision to die.
Amen.
Only for them. It may be a little bit difficult initially. You know, people thought that there was something I was looking for. When I said this, that man is something. I said, look, by God's grace, I already have a big church. I'm not looking for something, it's costing me something. So when you say, I'm bringing a man from Nigeria, I'm doing everything, they will think, first of all, they think you have a hidden agenda. That's the normal thing. They will say, I can't somebody be spending so much money. Thousands of dollars. He's looking for something. Not like they accused Lot. Do you want to be ruler over us? But you don't know that there's something, a kingdom passion in you. You don't think that anybody can do anything because of the passion for the kingdom. It took them many years before they became relaxed. For many years, we never did the meeting in our church. From Trade Center, we went to a trade fair. Then the minute provincial pastor of Redeem came and said, brother, this thing is too expensive and you are the only one bearing it. My provincial headquarters is there. Okay, we now moved. Because I didn't want them to say there was anything. And God knew my heart. I was not looking for anything. I'm still not looking for anything. So we moved to Redeem headquarters. But again, some of the funny denominational things.
Always
crazy things. So two times they locked us out. It was the last time we said, we had to look for vehicles to take people. That was what brought it. It was by accident that the lad came to our church. The church was there empty, but we couldn't bring him because we didn't want him to stay. But when you are locked out, the first time I called the pastor, I asked them to open. The second time they were, it was like. We see, there strength and security in bonding. When there is bonding, we are difficult to be separated. When there is bonding, we make unusual impact within a short time. We make unusual impact within a short time. That's why I said, this week God is leading you to. You don't have to be the biggest, but God gives the vision to one man. Within a short time, we make unusual impact. Let me just look at three facts very quickly. Number one, refusing distractions. Number two, reasonable determination. Number three, recruiting dependables. All these three things are very important. Refusing distraction, reasonable determination, recruiting dependables. I will look at this very, very briefly, but I can assure you within the next 15 minutes, I'm done. Look at it. In those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Christians against the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reasonable, it is not reasonable that we should leave the essential thing at staff tables. Listen, there are many things that will usually want to distract us from our major course in life. I don't know, that's why I'm talking to you. I will speak to my son Philip also. That's what I'm talking to you. There are distractions, especially when you do something that will affect posterity. Look at Nehemiah. You can read through Nehemiah chapter 2. You see, the moment they said, even the Sanballat, Tobiah, it all rose up against him. And all through, at every stage, they were giving him trouble. Chapter 4 said, what we are even building, when an ox, a fox starts upon it to be collapsed. Who is Pastor Festus? When did he come to our altar? Who has chosen him to be this? They were giving trouble from stage to stage. They even appointed a prophet against Amadiah. Caused everything to take place. They intimidated him. Said, how can a man like me be afraid? So they used everything to change his course. All I'm trying to say, when you start a great thing, there will always be destruction. Look at Jesus Christ. In Luke chapter 4, let me just see that. Luke 4, verse 41. Because of distractions are sought to. Look at it. And devils came out of many, crying out and saying, thou art Christ, the Son of God. And he rebuking them, suffered them not to speak, for they know that he was Christ. And when the day was come, he departed and went into a desert place. And the people sought him and came unto him and stayed him that he should not depart from them. Please stay here. You see, it's a distraction. Stay. We have enjoyed your ministry. What did he say? Verse 43. And he said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also. For therefore I said, I can stay here with you. There are other people waiting for me. That was a distraction. They wanted to make him king. Everything. But you see, you may not know the distractions. They will be there here and there. But God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In chapter 4, you see even the destruction of hunger, of hardship, all these things. God will help. Look at Paul. Look at him. Acts chapter 20. They are always there for everybody who wants to make it. Acts chapter 20. See from verse 21. Testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now behold, I go bound in the spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, except that the Holy Ghost is witnessing in every city, saying that bond and afflictions abide me. So anybody wants to do great things, but he says none of these things move me. In chapter 21, see again, verse 11. And when it was come unto us, he took Paul's girdle and bound his own hands and feet and said, thus said the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews in Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle and shall deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. And when we have these things, both we and they of that place besought him not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, only, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. Listen, if you are not ready to die for a cause, for a vision, you will not go far. And that's our major problem today. Nobody wants to die. Nobody. Nobody. And that's why you see these other people, they are moving faster and becoming a threat to the whole world. They are ready to die for the cause they believe in. We are not ready. They are ready to spend. Yes, you see the difference. When you look at the missionary spending, is becoming reduced. But they are adding more. That's the problem we are even having in Nigeria. Listen, Boko Haram is well equipped and they have money. They have money! That then they say if you can kill one minister, 500,000, 1 million. It came to a point that our military people, they had to admit they are better equipped. They are better motivated. It's painful. Ah, look at them now moving with rockets, moving with armored tanks. Where did they get armored tanks from? But God will help us in Jesus' name. From the text, we see possible distractions. Number one, success. Fame and popularity. That can be one of the greatest distractions you have in life. Now, everybody has moved. They've been so successful. You see, the number of disciples multiplied greatly. Not just attendees, disciples, those who have made genuine commitment to Christ. And say, let me take care of this one now. If I don't, you see, no, that's what my church, my ministry, my ministry. They will have said, we have arrived. Success, very few people know how to manage success. And that's one of the problems we have. I remember I was in Chicago at the Waiting Center, 1982, where I had a missions conference in Michigan. From there, I moved to Chicago. Then I went to TEAM, the Evangelical Alliance Missions. I was talking to, I think, Dr. Rodias, the missions secretary. And I was just sharing with me what you have achieved. What's the secret? You've been there for many long years. He said, Alfred, from what I've heard from you, you people have gone far within a short time. I was missions director. Then he gave me an illustration. He said, I think it's with George Foreman. He said, when he was about to fight a particular battle, he said, which is the new strategy you are going to use? He said, I'm not going to use any new strategy. The old strategy that have been giving me achievements, he said, I don't want to play with success. You see, success can be played with. The moment you start to dabble and tamper with what brought you there, you will go down. So, they would have said, these people are there. Okay, let's go and be doing other things. So success could be a good. Obviously, what they talk, God talk about Jethro. Now that you have eaten, you have waxed strong. That's success. This thing is small today, but note it. It is going to become big.
Amen.
But you must learn how to manage success. Because that's what has killed most of our people. Success will bring a lot of distractions. Look at what happened in Samaria. I still say, God, if it were me, would I have passed that story? That test. I say, God, I don't know what you are gracious. Look at Philip. The whole Samaria was now Philip. Even the man who had been regarded as the power of God, the great power of God. You see, they all bowed. It was Philip's show. Philip, the man of the hour. And God now came and said, Philip, my servant, move to Giza, the desert. This depart from me, devil. Get thee behind me, question. How can I live with the great revival God and go to Giza, the desert? Who lives in the desert? What would I have for these people here? But the man moved. He moved to Giza. And when I say Giza, it was real desert. I go to Israel most of the time. We have a church there. I'll be going again September this year by God's grace to have a program. So when they say desert, it was desert. But God has an assignment for him. Don't you know that this man endured the ministry? Oh, that's why we discovered we never had, apart from Stephen and Matthew, all the other people, we didn't hear about them apart from Philip. Come to chapter 28, chapter 21, you see Paul residing in the house of Philip, the evangelist, with four of his daughters. You know, not only you know, he was able to impact his daughters. He was a man. The experiences he had, it wasn't written about any other person. After he finished preaching, no, before they realized they saw him in Azotus, he was implanted by the power of the Holy Spirit. An obedient person will go find life. Ooh! Let me ask you a question. How obedient are you? Even when God is saying things that you don't understand, how can I lead these multitudes and go to Gaza in the desert? With what God has done here, Hebrew spirit is going on, everybody shouting. But God is the owner of the church. Don't you think, I'm church, my church, my church. It's not your church. I will be my church. So success can be a great distraction. You know what Moses, what Jethro told Moses? Is the people coming? It's not me. He said, you will wear yourself out on these people. This thing you are doing is not good. So when success comes, many of us will run into trouble. Number two, there may be some side issues. Just like what happened. People talking here and there, murmuring, grumbling. We don't understand. This is our pastor. We don't understand. All our money. He's using it for conferences. All our money. Side issues. If you are not careful to close your ears, you will miss it. John Wesley says whoever wants to conduct an orchestra will mark the audience. You don't back the audience, they do say if you are not careful, they do some things you are provoked. Yeah. Hey, look at the man. But no. Back him. Number three, your siblings. Not the much they did for Jesus Christ. They did not believe in him. Look at John chapter 7. Your siblings can be a great distraction. See, he says, his brethren, verse 3, therefore said unto him, depart thee and go into Judea, that the disciples may see thy works and thou dwest. For there's no man that doeth anything in secret. And he said, seek it to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself in the world. Look at verse 5. For neither did his brethren believe in him. In you, Jesus, Savior. That's when they will be ministering. People will just say, please call him for us. Is it your mother? Call it for us. Call it. They will not come inside though. Call it for us. So if you're not careful, you'll be distracted. But he will say, who are my brothers? Who are my sisters? What is people who sit down and listen to me? So am I teaching you something this morning? That's why I say this one is more important to me than all this one, because I'm giving you stuff that will take you far in life and in ministry. He was able to overcome it. He didn't allow them to distract him. Then at times, there may be strength developments. People will start to say some things from nowhere. You are doing everything that we don't. Strange! And then some of those strange men are from nobles. Like the Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. It's the only that is anointed. Why should it be him and the wife? What is it that Pastor Fessor can do that I cannot do? You will not be surprised. Where did this all come from? You're not happy at times. Your heart is broken. These are issues. Next, there can be stressors. Things that are just there. Then another problem may be suffering. Things that can distract you. I know I've been serving God with all my heart, with all my strength. Why is it that I don't get everything? Some of this my labors are getting. You see, some people, you know, they don't fast the way you fast, they don't preach the way you preach. But you see, when you look at external things, today they say they're in Jamaica, the next day they're in Barbados, the next they are drinking their cars every 3 months. And you know that you are not a lazy man. At times, things are tough. Like, have to make an application for some of those people say, I give money out in tens of thousands of dollars. I say, hey, it is America. How do they make it? And you just know at times too, you have to believe God and there are things. Sufferings or some abnormalities. If you are not careful, it may put you and say, why should this happen to me? But God knows what he's doing. The sufferings of this time, they are not palatable, but they work out the peaceable work of righteousness. That's the truth. You don't see any genuine child of God, any person who will go far, who does not go through his wilderness experience. Look at Moses, 40 years. I was there. You will say, God, where are your promises? Look at me. Where are your promises? All you've told me. Look at all that abandoned me, the greatest king of my generation. Look at Joseph, a man with a coat of many colors, languishing in the prison. That's the truth. So, at times, if you don't know what great men have gone through, I was telling them, I said, have you seen a man walking behind two coffins at the same time? These are not coffins carrying animals, they are carrying your own flesh. It's better imagined than experienced. Yes. Carry your own flesh. But if God allows it, it's because he wants it that way. You don't go through that path, you don't get to your ultimate. His ways are not our ways. That's why we don't question him for anything. All I'm trying to say is that sufferings, they are meant to do you good. They give you experiences which others have not, and because God wants to do what he has never done in their lives, in your life.
Amen.
So that's why you don't insult him. You keep thanking him for counting you feet to go through such a tough things. Yes. When you look at God, how did he die? People, you just know that it is God, because as you were there, every step you were taking, he was watching you. Watching you. November 19th this year, last year, I was chilling with one of my spiritual daughters here. And we're talking, when we turned 18 last year. And as we were talking, we were just praising God and burst into prophetic words, strong prophetic words. What did God say? Say, my son, I want to let you know how happy I have been with you. How happy I've been with your life and the work you are doing for me. It's also true, I want to tell you how I was so happy that even in your dark moments, you never use your tongue against me. God, I never knew God was watching. And so today, I want to tell you things in my heart. You know, September last year, a minister was coming from Abia State to Enugu State to meet. So he was spending time before the Lord and waiting on him. And he said, the Lord said, when you get to Enugu, I want to give you a special message to my friend. So he was checking out. You have a friend? We only know of Abraham, your friend. He said, when it's time, I will tell you. So when he was about to leave, he said, when you get to Enugu, go to my friend, Alfred Ijewe. I speak to him mouth to mouth. See, again, what happens? He took me through tough times. And by his grace, I never failed him. But I said, many people have failed. They would have been distracted. Why? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Like, I still read it. When he was telling, who are you to question my wisdom? Say, God can allow in his wisdom what he could have presented by his power. Say, who are you to question what? My wisdom! He's suffering God. If he allows it, oh, praise him. But many people have been distracted. Let me just say before I conclude that whatever is happening, remember your commitments. Whatever is happening, remember your consecration. Whatever is happening, remember your crown. There is a crown ahead for you. Let me just go through this. Because reasonable determination is that we will give ourselves continually to prayers. They were settled on the issues of prayers. They were very strong on the issue of prayers. They were stubborn. That's what is important. They were stubborn about prayers. They realized the power, the possibilities, and the penetration that will come through the advice and ministry. If they will pray. One major thing that is worthy of praise, we will give ourselves the continuity. We will give ourselves continually. You see, that's what I'm saying, that I don't know. I mean, by after we finish tomorrow, there should be some decisions. There should be no stopping, no slacking behind, no slowing down, no surrender after this program.
Amen.
I don't know how tomorrow's service will look like, but there must be decisions. We must organize prayer chains, prayer cells. God has put you into what is bigger than you. Continuity. And then continuing. Steadfastly. So without continuity, not much will be achieved. Look at what they say. We. And that's what it should be. Every one of us. All the ministers in World Assembly. Members of the choir. We. When we start, you say, when we add that we concept, nobody can stop you.
Amen.
When it's not there, they are having a prayer crusade. I don't understand it very well. I don't understand it. We are having a program. We. And everything, like I told you, that's Philip when was talking to me, said, sir, how do you want us to book your this thing? Say, when do you want to come in? How do you want to? He says, where do we root you from? From Lagos. I said, don't root that, my son. Just get me from Houston. I'll pay my way down. But what I'm trying to say is that this is our program. Even though it's not here. He says, sir, please will pardon me. I said, my son, don't give yourself stress. I understand. Everybody, even those who are not here, we should have our weapons in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Recruiting dependables. In Acts, you see in our text, look for other people who can do things. Listen, no one is sufficient. The more we are, the better. But it should be dependable people, people who meet with some basic qualifications. Who are the dependables? Four things. They must be men of similar passions, men of similar purpose, men of similar priority, men of similar pursuit, men who are focused on this issue we are talking about, men who are fervent, men without personal or selfish agenda, men who want only something, the glory of God. Those will go far. Those people will go far. Let me just show you this, then we'll start to pray. In 2 Samuel chapter 10, again, bonding. 2 Samuel chapter 10, I'll read from verse 9. It says, when Joab saw that the front of the battle was against him, before and behind, he chose of all the chosen men of Israel and put them in array against the Syrians. And the rest of the people he delivered unto the hand of Abishai, his brother, that he might put them in array against what? The children of Ammon. Look at verse 11. And he said, if the Syrians be too strong for me, then thou shalt help me. But if the children of Ammon be too strong for thee, then I will come and help thee. Look at verse 12. Be of good courage. Let us plead the men for our people and for the cities of God. And the Lord that and the Lord do that which is made him good. That's it. Who are the people who want to plead the men for God and their generation? That's why I'm here.
Amen.
I said, this is a noble cause. I need to give it all my attention. Amen. After I went to the hotel on Thursday, I didn't come out until I was coming here yesterday. No water, no food. said, no, don't come at 19 because I still want to spend time to pray. Brethren, who are those people who want to pray? Amen. For God and this generation. Are there people like that here today? Let's play the man. Let's risk our lives. Let's bound together and do something genuine. You have such people here this day who want to play the man. You have anybody like that here this morning who like Job and say, let's play the man. I will be waiting for you to come and help me. You know, people, they think they're all in God. It's not possible. I ever pick a church is in this area before that people. I'm telling you, it's not possible. There are things, except you become God. It's only God who does not need any other person. But who are the people here this morning? So we are ready to play the man for God and for our generation. If you're here, can I see your hands up? That I mean it with my all my heart. I want my life to count. You see, it's not, it doesn't, I want my life to count. If that is you, raise your hands. Then, if you don't mind, rise to your feet. Rise to your feet. Rise to your feet. You see, great things start like this. One thing you'll be sure, God is here.
Amen.
If you have been following the teaching, you'll see that this is the mind of God that I'm sharing with you. I'm not sure. These are not my words. I can sense it. That I am sharing with you the mind, the passion of God. God. Let's give God a wave of faith. Just give him a wave.
Father,
give him a wave of faith. Give him a wave of faith. Give him a wave of faith. Ramatuka, Tuka, Postia, Brazil, Babo, Ramika, Mantuka, Zita, just give God a wave of faith this morning. Babo, Leshka, Mutokana, Balika, Babo, Shanda, Rabasu, Kababa, Brodika, 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 Basuka, Balika, Kaba, Radika, Doshka, Batoria, Ramatu, Balika, 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 Rumimo, Dombia, Basaba, Radika, Nimo, Shaka, Yaba, Balika, no send Babu, Balika, fight you, Lord. God wants to do some unusual things this morning or this afternoon. Don't be sensitive and listen to the Spirit of God. Raise your two hands. Say, Father, I thank you for bringing me here today.
I thank you for bringing me here today.
I thank you for your very plan for my life.
I thank you for your very plan for my life.
I thank you for your plan for this city.
I thank you for your plan for this city.
I thank you for your plan for this state.
I thank you for your plan for this.
I thank you for your plan for this generation.
I thank you for your plan for this generation.
Oh, God.
Oh, God.
I can't hear you very well. Part of answer. I pray.
I pray.
Oh God.
Oh God.
Bring back.
Bring back.
Bring restoration.
Bring restoration.
To your distracted church.
Distracted church.
Church is distracted.
Show me
Jesus. Church is distracted.
My
Shalom. Oh God.
ask the Lord to lay his hands afresh upon you. Say, Baba, by your grace, I will not disappoint you. By your grace, I will not fail you. By your grace, I will not fail you. You can use me as an instrument of change, an instrument of transformation. I receive grace and help for this hour. Man shall master. It's a solemn hour. Amen. Before I pray, just listen to what God is telling you in your inner mind before I pray for you. God wants to get your attention. The Spirit of God is so real here now. This is a solemn and a solid moment where you see an interplay between heaven and earth. Key into this moment to make definite consecration to God. Definite commitment. This is an unusual hour. Answer your head in prayer. Heavenly Father, this is a very, very solemn moment. These are your precious children. Look at them before you. They mean business for you and for this generation. I pray that you will lay your hands so mightily upon them. You will lay your hands so mightily, that there's an arising, fresh glory, the rising with fresh unction, the rising with fresh possibility, that in this land, in this generation, use them to showcase your glory. Lord, we're not worthy of what you have come to do here this morning. But Father, we want to promise you, we will not take you for granted. We know that you are doing, the Lord says, is doing even what you have not asked in your life. Sadoshka, I will plead with you, still spend some time in his presence. It's a very solemn moment. Just open your heart and put your heart to him. This is, I pity those who are not here this morning. This is just a solemn moment. An unusual moment. A moment of grace. A moment of destiny.
I surrender all to Thee, my Lord.
surrender all.
Shandor Bogorosh, Imbarudo Sigiri.